So let me continue my picture. So is yesterday, the day before actually. So I talked about some introductory part, general formulation. Now I focus on inflation. And as I told you yesterday, the inflation is to solve so-called horizon problem, but the horizon problem in this sense is to solve for is origin, to answer the question of the origin of the perturbations, and not the origin of homogeneity and isotropy. Homogeneity and isotropy is assumed in the inflationary models. So it's not a consequence of inflation, but it's the assumption of inflation. Okay. That's something you have to think. I mean, that's something, so inflation definitely has, I mean, still have some initial condition problem, which should be solved someday. Anyway, so these are the equations I showed you yesterday. And so from here, so as I said, let's consider a standard sort of Einstein theory coupled with the minimally coupled scalar field, a real scalar field, and assume this dominates the universe and it derives inflation. Okay, then I part out this around this about inflation in the background, and the perturbation will be given by this perturbation in the Lux function shift vector and this curvature perturbation and the trace. Another big part. And as you could see, I mean, here, instead of using this, this Fourier decomposition, I tried to write everything in terms of some function given a derivative, special derivatives of some function. So they, of course, equivalent, as you can see, this A corresponds to just A summation over AK by K, Y is the harmonics, and B response of this and so on and so forth. Okay? And so we have four algebraic degrees of freedom as we discussed, and one degree of freedom from scalar field. And we have two constraint equations, Hamiltonian constraint, momentum constraint, so which kills all the degrees of freedom of metric. But we have scalar field, so essentially the scalar field has dynamical degrees of freedom. In any case, you can expand that action, this action, to the second order. First order vanishes because the background of the equation is motion, and at second order you get this. This is sort of a bit complicated, but it's interesting. Well, maybe not so interesting. But for example, if you look at the this appearance of this Laplace function perturbation, it appears in combination either in this form when the time derivative is appearing, or in this form. And as we all know, that they never have contains its own time derivative. Same with B. And the further interesting thing is that in this linear perturbation, case of linear perturbation, this HT never appears. This HT is the anisotropic component of metric perturbation. Never appears as it is, and just linear in the time derivative. This is just a special property, probably of Einstein theory, maybe, or some class of theories. Anyway, so since we have to deal with the constraint equation system, the standard ways go to the Hamiltonian formulation and solve the constraint equation and reduce the dynamical degrees of freedom. So this is what you do. The canonical momentum is defined from usual way. So for a scalar field, a conjugate would be like this. And for this Fourier curvature perturbation, the conjugate is given by some fairly complicated manner. For the conjugate momentum for the HT, you have this form, and because it is actually, as you could easily see, that apart from the Laplacian, the derivative and signature, derivative of action in this respect HD is the same as the derivative with respect to B, which means that this part, which corresponds to this momentum of the HD, is actually a constraint, momentum constraint, which is what it should vanish. So, anyway, in any case, that's some beta story. As we usually do in the Hamiltonian formulation, that we construct Hamiltonian in terms of the, well, first we have to solve this. For example, the chi prime is solved in terms of p chi, and r prime is solved in terms of pr, hd in terms of hd, hd, well, actually doesn't, cannot. This. Cannot be solved. In this combination, you can solve, because you have this. So this combination, you solve this, and so you plug this back, and you get the Hamiltonian in terms of the moment, canonical conjugate variables, okay? And A and B. So the result takes this form. You have this canonical conjugate PQ, where P represents R, HD, and chi, the curvature correlation, and the anisotropic part, and the field, the scalar field, and their momentum conjugates. And some Hamiltonian, which is a bit complicated, I haven't written it down, you can find it somewhere. Or if you want to know it, I can show it to you later. But, then you have some constraints, actually. So A, as I said, A and B does not contain any time derivative, so the coefficient of that would be a constraint. And this CA corresponds to the moment, a Hamiltonian constraint, it's given in this form. And CB corresponds to the momentum constraint, and actually, as I said, it's just equal to the momentum of the HD. So this is the system, and we know that these constraints are so-called first-class constraints. Introduces the gauge, the gauge transformation, and as you could easily see from, for example, considering gauge transformation of this type, and then transformation generated by taking a Poisson bracket of some quantity with this combination of constraints. So this is a very, I'd say, simplest special case of gauge theory. This theory is usually much more complicated, but this, since it's linear, everything is very simple. Okay. And of course, by the way, so when I reduce the action, our Hamiltonian. Standard sort of old-fashioned way is the so-called Dirac's method, but which I used when I first quantized the system. But then I got to know this method by Fadif and Jakif, and their method turned out to be very powerful, especially at this linear perturbation. It's almost trivially very useful. So I will use that. So this is how you do it. Since we know the Hamiltonian momentum constraints are gauge invariant, you can construct the Hamiltonian, but you consider the Lagrangian in the first order form, and this is the essence of the Fadif-Jakif, because this action itself is gauge invariant. Okay, Hamiltonian is not gauge invariant. If you do some coordinate canonical transformation, so on, the Hamiltonian changes. And so by doing some kind of performing some gauge transformation, it can change. But we know the constraints are gauge invariant. They are gauge invariant up to, of course, gauge constraints. So, and the total Lagrangian, of course, is gauge invariant, because we just expanded the gauge invariant action to second order. So action must be gauge invariant. So that's why don't go to Hamiltonian, but they always keep the Lagrangian home. And then you can plug all these constraints into the action because they are gauge invariant. So without worrying about the problem of gauge and so on, you can just solve a constraint equation and plug back into the action, and which does not violate anything. And so of course there are many choices. In for example, the simplest case, which is quite usually done in our a cosmological perturbation case, is to solve for p chi. This CA equals, as I told you, from something. Yeah, this form. So as you could see, the simplest, well, you could use this, but the simplest one is either p chi or pr. So you just solve for p chi or solve for pr and plug back in. Yes, to the action. And also insert the CB, this is simple. I mean, it's just, you just put the momentum of HT equal to zero, that's all, and nothing else. So the resulting action is in this form. You have the PR and R and chi. P chi disappear. So, but in terms of Hamiltonian first order formalism, you only have to have only 2 degrees of freedom, which means that one of the degrees of freedom is redundant, meaning that actually by considering some gauge transformation, some of these will combine into a gauge invariant combination. I mean, that must be the case if you didn't do any incorrect computation. And actually, you can easily see that's the case. In this case, you find actually, of course, by given this, then you know from using this gauge transformation rules that how those variable transformers are gauged. So it's very easy to find the gauge invariant combination between these two variables. I just plug this into this, take the Poisson bracket with respect to this CA and CB, and you easily see how they transform. Yes. In particular, actually, CB doesn't play it at all because there is nothing which is related to this variable HP appears already in this level. So it's very simple. And you immediately find in solve for pi chi, you find this, you can, everything is formed, as it takes a form in this form. It's very simple. And you see that this PC or RC is a gauge invariant combination. And the reason why, I mean, it's, of course, there may be some different way of choosing them, but the important thing is that you choose some, the factor, the combination in front of the hazard. So the factor in front should be chosen, I mean, relative factor, so that the this PR prime, or I mean it's PQ dot term, in the action has a coefficient of the unity. And if you do that, then everything is automatic. So this is very simple. This is a very simple, interesting exercise. And then once you do this, then you realize actually these gauge invariant variables are actually gauge invariant variables defined on the curvature perturbation, defined in chi equals zero, meaning that chi is the fluctuation scalar field. So it is, so you put the scalar field fluctuation equals zero, then you get this action. So this PC is actually PR and RC is actually this R. In this so-called co-moving slices where scalar field is taken to the homogeneous. So this is the action you get in the first order form. You can always go back by using the relation between these two, and by taking derivative with C prime, you know how PC is given in terms of the RC prime. So you can convert back to the second order form, and this second order form action is the famous form in this, with this G square.
How do you relate this choice of coordinates to what we observe?
For the moment, there's nothing is related to observable. It's just taking out the some dynamical degrees of freedom, reduction of the system.
You choose a gauge.
Essentially, as I said, it corresponds to choosing the gauge in which the scale field fluctuation vanishes.
But usually it's nice to take what one calls the physical gauge, like A0 equal to 0, depends on the problem you study.
So which goes to 0?
For instance, if you look at QED, or if you look at something which is static, you better to go to Coulomb gauge, Tangerine gauge. Okay. And here you have a choice of gauge, but somehow you want to relate what you compute to what you measure. So.
Yeah, well, I mean,
there are better gauges.
As I said in the first day, I mean, in Einstein theory, it's very difficult or sometimes misleading to define what is observable. From the beginning, observables are defined only operationally by sort of specifying what you do.
Yes. But here, normally, you want to study, you have a theory of inflation, and you want to relate something that you compute.
For example, CMB fluctuations and so on.
Yes.
And those fluctuations can be written in terms of some gauge invariant variables, but this choice is arbitrary. I mean, you can choose any gauge. Not in principle.
In fact, computations is easy.
As far as computation part is concerned, then it also depends on what kind of model you're considering. Mm-hmm. And sometimes in some models, some choice of variables are not so adequate, and you easily make mistakes. So in that sense, even if you know you're dealing with some dynamical variables, sometimes you always nicely consider the gauge transformation to other gauges and see how some variable behaves in another gauge. And if you see some strange behavior in another gauge, either it is genuine this strange behavior or you made some mistake. So this is in practice you have to do such things. I mean, there's no almighty gauge. There doesn't exist almighty gauge in cosmology. Yes.
The co-moving slicing means what exactly, physically?
Physically means that you take the slice in which fluctuations in the scalar field vanishes. So this is a very good gauge when you deal with some scales much greater than large scales. Where you can, as I said, on large scales, geometry is more important. So therefore, putting some fluctuations in matter field equal to zero makes sense. But this doesn't make sense at all on small scales. Like in this room, if you put the fluctuation of any fundamental field equal to zero, your slicing would be probably not spatial. I mean, you get a very, very highly singular Hamiltonian. So this means that this choice of gauge is not recommended when you deal with some small scale or maybe quantization of the system. But when you deal with large scales, infrared physics, in cosmology or in relativity, then this gauge probably is a good gauge. That's the only thing we can say. There are, of course, some counter examples, as I said. I mean, you have to be careful.
For instance, yesterday you had a pike. I mean, you had this.
And then,
is it suitable gauge to?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So that spike comes from the perturbation in this quantity, and which is a spike in those so-called curvature perturbation on scales much greater than the horizon. Mm-hmm. So since you're dealing with large scale.
That's a good gauge.
That's right. Yes.
For this phenomenon.
I mean, depending on what you deal with, yes. But that's one thing. Yeah. Anyway, so in this case, you can, I mean, it doesn't have to, but you can go back to the sort of a second order Lagrangian, because it's more kind of, how to say, intuitively clear for us. I mean, Hamiltonian formalism sometimes becomes quite obscure for us. So Lagrangian formulation, we know Lagrangian formulation better. So this. And then, yeah, well, here I'm just this a note. I mean, here in front, the sound velocity is unity, but this just is because we are dealing with this canonical scalar field. And if you not dealing with canonical scalar field, you get some non-trivial sound velocity. But that's something I wouldn't discuss here. But anyway, so. So you can easily write down the equation of motion, and now this is what I'm just going into the Fourier modes, because when you do the quantization, essentially you, in this case you do the standard Fock space quantization where you decompose the field into the Fourier modes, and you introduce this creation of natural operators and so on and so forth. So working in the Fourier space is more useful, easy. That's why I write it down. But in any case, important thing is that here, again, now if you take the k goes to zero limit, independent of the behavior of this function g, g is given by this. And actually, in our case, we assume the scalar field, the single scalar field model, with some potential, but actually it doesn't have to scalar field or anything. Any background universe which is consistent with Einstein theory can be used to consider this perturbation, which is known. In any case, which means that this solution, so large scale, so when k goes to zero, one solution is just a constant, and the other solution, usually, because z is proportional to scale factor, one over z usually decays out. So, you have these two sort of exact solutions, and this actually the one which is constant usually it's not growing, but which is called growing mode in some sense relative to this decaying mode. But anyway, so the whole point is that if this decay mode actually decays out, that means that if this function z is growing in time, then a growing mode stays constant on supervariant scale, some horizon scales. But and this existence of constant mode is general property of n equals most model, but as I emphasize that this does not mean that there will be perturbation. In the case of people usually say that when you consider only the perturbation, this curvature perturbation on commodity slices conserved or constant on supervisor scales, but that's not exactly true. I mean, so the condition is that if the other mode, where this prime is proportional 1 over z, actually decays up, if this decaying mode is actually decaying, then this condition is okay, and this statement is okay. But otherwise, it's wrong. Okay. Anyway, now, this is sort of a large scale point of view, but so more intuitively, and especially when you want to quantize the system, probably it's better to look at, say, fluctuation from matter point of view. And so therefore, in some sense, you minimize the fluctuation geometry. In this case, the one of the most sort of simplest choice is to take the curvature perturbation equal to zero. So this means that you choose your spatial hypersurface to be flat, intrinsically flat, so that you get rid of the effect of geometry as much as possible. then you can easily see, actually, this inverting this, just multiplied by this 5 a prime over h, and then which corresponds to this variable, actually is a scalar field of fluctuations defined on oracle Z gauge. So it's the flat, the fluctuation of the scalar field in flat slicing. And so there's a very, very simple relation that curvature perturbations in commoving slice is related to fluctuations in the scalar field on flat slicing by this factor. Yes, this is, there's a one-to-one correspondence. This one-to-one correspondence is true as long as phi prime is non-vanishing. But as soon as phi prime vanishes, this relation is invalidated. Actually, this curvature perturbation becomes ill-defined. So we have to choose some other gauges. But anyway, so during inflation, when phi prime or phi dot actually is non-vanishing, this is a good relation. Okay? And if you change this, this is just a contact transformation, huh? From the change of value from RC to time. Okay? Very easy. I mean, you just plug this back into this action.
I'm a bit confused.
Yeah.
Okay, you do some computations. In this case, the inflaton is what is left from the matrix after gauge fixing, or it's a scalar field that is independent?
I'm dealing with so-called scalar type perturbations, where if you don't have any matter field, the geometry doesn't have contain any degrees of freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so GL contains only in dynamical degrees of GL is only gravitational wave or tensor mode. So scalar mode doesn't contain intrinsic dynamical degrees of freedom. However, once you couple the gravity with some scalar modes, then this can become dynamical. Huh? But in the price you have to pay is that then either you think the geometry is dynamical, where this matter is subject to this geometry, or you assume matter is dynamical and geometry is subject to geometry, the matter. The latter viewpoint is usually what we do, for example, in the Newtonian gravity, where the Newtonian potential is just simply given by Laplacian. Pi is given by fluctuation in the matter field. So as soon as you know how matter field behaves, then you can compute the corresponding Newtonian potential and so on and so forth. So either you can make matter to be dynamical or geometry to be dynamical. And actually, in the case of inflation, if you choose the commoving slice, then you make the geometry to be dynamical and the matter to be non-dynamical. While if you choose curvature equal to zero, you make the geometry to be non-dynamical and the curvature. So that's, and this is the relation.
But at the origin, you have only the matrix, or you have the matrix, you have to do some gauge fixing. At the beginning,
the whole point is that you don't have to do gauge fixing from the beginning. Actually, as I have, this is the Padefchakiv's sort of a superior point. You don't have to realize you are doing gauge fixing. By solving constraint, you automatically fix the gauge. I mean, depending on how you choose how to, for example, in this case,
yeah.
I solve for p chi, that's why, I mean, p chi disappears from the action, which means you get rid of the matter degrees of freedom. That's why you get back with the curvature perturbation. But if you, for example, if I choose for pr, you can choose ca equals 0, can choose just the p of r. Huh?
So it's really pure zero of gravity.
Yeah, if you do that, then P of R disappears from the action,
mm-hmm.
and you get, end up with this the matter action. So it's purely the matter of how you solve the constraints and plug back into the action. But when you do your computation, you don't have to realize you are doing this. I mean, it's technically simpler. Okay, you don't have to consider the gauge fixing condition and whether you know you have just proper commutators so that you know the gauge conditions do not commute and so on and so forth. You know, all these things you have to think.
It means you... that it's a very appropriate gauge for the problem.
Sorry.
This co-moving.
Mm-hmm.
This co-moving
yeah.
Something. It's a very appropriate gauge for studying this.
It's a scale, fluctuations on the large scale, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And of course, in the linear theory, and this is at the linear level, anything is okay. But the, as soon as you go to the second order and higher order, this gauge, I mean, when you try to think of all the small scale fluctuations, for example, this gauge is not so good. So you have to be very careful.
Co-moving gauge.
As I said, if you consider the fluctuations in this, say, room, you know, you should be able to. I mean, of course, it's a highly nonlinear cosmological perturbation, but still, you can apply some cosmological perturbation theory. But in this case, it's very difficult to imagine the slice, time slice, in which we have no, say, fluctuation density. I mean, this is absurd, huh? It's such an absurd state.
It's the equivalence principle, isn't it?
Yeah. But on small scales where we don't feel gravity at all, and if you try to make gravity dynamical, you have to take a slice in which, say, for example, in our case, we have some density here, and slightly different density here, and so on. Now, if you try to take this hypersubs where density is uniform, you may do it in the very, very small regions. But as soon as you go a little bit away, this hypersub becomes singular, and then you know you cannot satisfy this condition. So this shows that you know. Mathematically, all this any gauge is equivalent, but physically, choosing this gauge on very very small scale is absurd. I mean, it's an unphysical gauge in some sense. I mean, it makes let's say for example when there is always a gravity, right? So you can make gravity to be dynamical here, you know, Newtonian gravity to be dynamical, while you make all the say matter degrees of freedom as a subject to that gravity. But this is a sort of way of expressing physics in small scale. Physics in small scale, gravity is meaningless, right? I mean, it's totally negligible. Apart from, the fact that the Earth is very large, so we're sitting on this Earth. But when we talk about interaction between you and me, and if you express everything in terms of gravity, that's crazy. So let's not do it. Huh? So that's my point. So this is the This is in some sense. So when you go to smaller scale, much intuitively clear gauge.
When was this?
Sorry.
When was this invented?
Where?
When was this invented? This gauge.
When
was he invented? When did you do it?
As far as I know, probably me and Kodama.
Yes, when?
So it's 80.
Earlier than.
Earlier than.
The other one was 89.
You mean the Fadefzaki?
No, the Komuni one. This is 89.
Sorry. This is the generalization, when CS.
Ah, okay.
So when CS is 1,
it's 86.
Historically, it's complicated, depending on who you talk to. I'm
talking to you.
In my case, I think I realized the importance of this gauge only after I introduced the coverage foundation, yes.
Uh-huh.
So it's in that sense it's after this. After this, yes. Yeah, but I think no the this is a when this I realized this when I was talking with Ewan Stewart. I should take a look at then we wrote a paper together. I mean, more general cases, probably sometime in the early 60s.
Yeah. This is usually in terms of main after you write the equation.
I guess so because I dealt with this part, yes, yeah. But physically, I like this quantity better because that gives you more. Has an intuitive way of how understanding what is going on inside the writing.
Yes.
Anyway, I remember this effect Marston. Probably I derived it first. For the first time, but I don't exactly remember when. Yes, my memory is scared. But anyway, the whole point is that so you can then write down the equation and the action as if this scalar field lives in just the background or some given, given homogeneous background with some mass, effective mass term, which contains not only the effective mass, but has some small correction suppressed by Cantor square. So this is usually a small correction. So this is how you can, and in this case, of course, you don't see any effect of gravity apart from this small correction to the mass term. Yes, gravitational correction in some sense. And then you can easily quantize this system thing. So, and especially in the case of an inflationary model, if the mass, intrinsic originally, the mass of this inflaton is small enough compared to the Hubble scale, and if inflation is slowly evolving, then this quantity is proportional to h prime, h dot, which is just epsilon parameter. So for inflation to be, say, quasi-exponential, this is always smaller than h. So this means that this m square is always smaller than h square during inflation, standard slow of inflation. So therefore, at leading order approximation, you can ignore one on a very high frequency limit. So when you do the Fock representation, and then you have essentially now that just becomes k over a square minus or plus a square. Yes. And then how are you? Okay. This chi square becomes square. But anyway, and then if this is much larger than the horizon, which is that your Moses is well within the horizon, which is where you want to quantize the system. Then, since this is much greater than the mass square, then at leading order you can completely ignore this mass scale. And also, when you are dealing with the very high frequency Moses and assuming this square is much small, then at leading order you can ignore the time variation of h. So at leading order, the simplest leading approximation, you can assume h to be a constant, which means that you have a Bessita space and you have an exact solution for scale factor in this case, and you can do the quantization. So that's the simplest thing you can do. Of course, in general, you don't have to do such approximation. This is when you compute the solution, look for the solution. But anyway, this is the standard way of quantization, as usual. introduce a canonical variable, canonical commutation relation, which is equivalent to introducing the equation of annihilation operator with the mode function, or usually positive frequency function, people call satisfying so-called this Klein-Golden normalization. And of course, Klein-Golden normalization doesn't fix which function you should take. There is always this linear transformation degrees of freedom, which is related to the volume of the transformation. So any given some chi, k, any chi k, say bar, which is given by alpha k, chi k plus beta k, chi k bar, where the alpha times beta equals 1. This new function is also a valid positive frequency function, and there is no definite sort of a choice on what what kind of this position alpha and beta should be chosen. But in our case, fortunately, this is again the you have this log n log deviation, and you have this horizon almost constant, and this k equal constant goes out of horizon. So which means that as you go back in time, all the modes comes in deep inside the horizon. And in this deep inside the horizon, in the reading of the approximation, of course, you can completely ignore the expansion of the universe. And the space, or space-time, looks exactly like Minkowski space. Again, this is the equivalence principle in some sense. So we know in that limit, we know the standard sort of vacuum must be there. So standard Minkowski type vacuum. So we know how specific frequency function should behave. Exponential ik, ikx, or ikb. And t in our case is eta, so you have specific choice. Once you have the specific choice, all the solutions are exactly fixed.
So this is when you do this canonical quantization,
yeah.
Eta
yeah.
is the coordinate.
The time coordinate.
You have the comoving frame, and then it's. How do you draw eta?
This is defined in the background. Okay. So this is related to yesterday's discussion. So there was some small confusions because of my lack of a very good way of expressing. But once you fix when you deal with those perturbations, we fix a background and perturb everything around this background. Then. We assume all the quantities are quantities defined on this background space.
Yes.
So everything is with respect to this background space. So any time or...
Which other time? And to the time for the background?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's eta.
Yeah, yeah, right. Mm. Yes. So all the sort of, how do you say, variables, you know, this, apparent eta, x, or, you know, anything, is with respect to the background. Yes, everything is defined on this background. Okay. Anyway, so you get this solution, and in the very high frequency limit, this has a standard sort of behavior that, apart from the scale factor dependence, which is always, you can actually make in this form if you put A in the physical, A in the there, then this A just corresponds to the size. In the standard sort of normalization, you have this 2 pi over 3, or 3 over half. Huh? And this is the, when you normalize the delta function, this disappears in infinite volume. And if you have some finite or some scale in the volume, you just have the scale A coming. And this is how this disappears. Okay. So it's essentially this square root 2a is square root 2 of k over a, which is just omega, a times a to 3 halves. Okay. Anyway, so this is what you get. But interesting thing is that as you go as time proceeds, then this, remember that A is in the stuff expression is eta, and eta from goes from minus infinity to zero, and this, so when eta goes to zero, because k eta goes to zero, so as the time goes on, k eta becomes less and less negligible, and the oscillation stops. And this is kind of the reflection of the fact that on scales greater than horizon, all the modes stops evolving but freezes up. Okay. But of course, on scales much greater than horizon, the approximation we did here is wrong, because you can no longer assume H to be a constant, no longer assume you are living in the distant space. So and no longer ignore the mass term. Okay. So this approximation is valid only on scales, maybe slightly greater than horizon, but not too large. But in any case, the whole point, but within that scale, you find that the fluctuations in those modes in the given, say, interval of the logarithmic frequencies, or you know, just multiply by phase volume, is equal to this h over 2 pi square, independent of k. Yes. And this is the reason why people want to relate this to Gibbons-Hawking temperature of the space. And because there may be some interesting analogy, and maybe this can be a useful analogy in some cases, but in most cases it's a dangerous analogy. Forget about this analogy. This is completely different from thermal effect energy. It's a pure quantum fluctuation. Anyway, so as I said, the standard approximation breaks down. Now the time variation of the fluctuation, the scale field cannot be neglected. However, actually we know, I mean, on large scale, I mean, which the action we started with before, we know that on large scale, anyway, one of the solutions must approach its constant. So in terms of RC, we know it approaches constant. So now this means that we don't really have to solve the behavior of high k, but just using this relation. Using this relation, you just in some sense, we know RC is a constant, so we know how this behaves on superlative scale. On superlative scale, this becomes a constant, so this time variation of this actually just depends, becomes like this. And actually, this is very easy to actually check. You can plug this in to this equation. Then in the k limit of k goes to zero, pi prime over h automatically satisfies this second order equation. So it's one of the solutions. It's very easy to check. Actually, probably it's from here it's very simple to see. You see, this is the solution. Then you take this second derivative, which corresponds to the second derivative of this part and so on. So anyway, that's it. So this is how you can solve the fluctuation on large scale. But the important thing is that in any case, we know on this small rule in single field case, this is a constant. This becomes a constant. So you can approximate this constant by just evaluating this value at what we call the horizon crossing here, because the value of this will not change much after it goes out of the horizon, and this will stay constant until it comes back in to the horizon. And the important thing, of course, is that if you have only single field which dominates the universe and nothing, no other field can play a role for the evolution of the universe, then this fact doesn't depend on the heating process or anything, because this is just purely property of this equation. Yes, and as long as this decaying mode is actually decaying, we know when k goes to zero, this must stay a constant. So it doesn't matter what kind of universe you're in or kind of heating process you go through. So that's why you can, without any ambiguity, predict the amplitude of curvature perturbations, and it comes inside of Einstein. And this, with this, you can compute single perturbations or galaxy correlation functions and everything. Okay. Now, this is about some comments. So let me just go further. Okay. So, so then, just summarizing the result we got. So we compute the curvature perturbation, which will be conserved on the supervised scale. A priori you don't know whether it is conserved, so we have that some time either here. But we know actually on scales greater than horizon, this is a constant. So and the constant value can be just given by the amplitude of the mode function, and this amplitude mode function. Function can be computed by this value at the horizon crossing, which is just given by h over 5 square or something, and when you take this into account, you get this result. So this is the dimensionless amplitude of the curvature perturbations you get when it comes inside the horizon. Now, one thing which you can notice from this is that since in this role of inflation, this number of waveforms is related to the this h over phi dot by this simple relation, because dn is minus h dt. This one over h over phi dot factor can be identified with this dn d phi. And then remaining is h over 2 phi. This h over 2 pi was the fluctuation we saw here at the horizon crossing. So you can regard this as given in terms of the derivative of the number of equals raised to pi times fluctuations delta pi evaluated on flat slices. Remember that here these fluctuations are evaluated on flat slices. Huh? Yes, this was evaluated at the flat slice. So if you identify these fluctuations delta pi as the one given on the flat slicing at the horizon crossing, then you have a relation, interesting relation, that the curvature perturbation you want to compute actually is given by the fluctuation of the number of waveforms is the fluctuation given by the fluctuation scalar field on flat slice. So this is the Dedekind formalism. And in this case, it's sort of an almost trivial relation because of the constancy of the curvature perturbation. But I will show after break.
The Dedekind formula, the one you showed yesterday, right?
Yeah, well, actually, yes. So you can generate this to a multi-field case very easily. And it's very easy to show why it is okay. But anyway, so this is the delta n formalism. First, without noticing all these relations and meaning of geometry, Stravinsky noticed this. That's why he was the one who should be cited. He always has very good intuition, but either he knows mathematics, sometimes he does, but even he doesn't know mathematics, he just knows the answer. that's what kind of things I always be sort of amazed by his work. Because every time I do something, he mentions that he did something similar and so on. And then when you look into it, the argument logic are very sort of shaky.
But the result is correct. Can be argued by biological analysis.
I don't know.
So what's the, I mean, this is called delta n. What's the significance of this formalism?
Significance?
Yeah.
So this means our logic, you say that now, this means that actually, this applies to the standard slow law, any kind of slow law, but multi-field inflation, that the curvature perturbation you want to compute can be simply computed by computing the fluctuations on flat slicing, fluctuations of scalar field on flat slicing, and at the horizon crossing, so that we don't have to evolve this further, and only the background evolution, number of people, dependence of n on, say, scalar field values. And if you know this, you can compute the fluctuations, second order, third order, anything. Mm. Yes. And this power has not been appreciated.
So this can be used to compute higher form functions, you see?
Oh, yeah.
But this is here, you derive it using the second, using the square.
Right. So that's,
this can be generalized.
That's the whole point. I mean, once you notice that actually this is more general than what we see here. Right.
So Sahovinsky has an argument for this without doing any of this mathematics?
Well, I think he simply realized that this form is actually this times pi over 2z, h over 2 pi.
And then he proposed this.
Not in this form, but essentially he says that the fluctuation can be computed in this form. I mean, it's identical to it. As you could see, I mean, in this case,
you cannot say it's identical.
Put it this way. In this argument, actually, this is just a result of interpretation of the world result. So there's no new, nothing new, right?
This is the relation between single.
And in the case of single field. You find that interpreting this result as the result of this is okay, but there's no proof or anything. It may be just a coincidence. Mm-hmm. Yes. So that's exactly what he did. But
he was right.
He's in general life. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Very, very amazing person. Anyway. Yes. So this is Anyway, so this is small thing. It's about the large angle symmetry, and SP. I'm not exactly sure. Anyway, yeah. So let me just briefly mention this, and then that's it. And then we go for break. Maybe too early. Maybe I don't know. Go to delta n forms. Okay, so what we do, I mean, this is a bit, now we have much more sort of accurate sort of way of analyzing things. So this is really, really a qualitative argument. But first of all, you have this relation between delta t over t with the Newtonian potential psi. This is called Zach's Wolf effect, and this is essentially the gravitational redshift. Yes. So, in the expanding universe, actually, not only just the gravitational potential itself, but you have some other contributions which make it instead of one third. And this depends on whether your fluctuations are adiabatic or non-adiabatic. And in this case, you assume adiabatic perturbation. But in any case, so using this, and by the way, psi is given by this 3 over 5 Carrier C, this 3 over 5 comes this 1 plus omega or this half plus I explained yesterday between two different phases. But anyway.
So that's the definition of psi, right?
Essentially, yes. Well, in matter dominated universe, by the way, yes. This 3 over 5 comes from matter dominated universe. In other universes, you have some corrections.
Equilibrium of state.
Yeah, equilibrium state. Depends on the equilibrium state. But anyway, so you just compute this, plug that in, then you find in a simple case of maybe, yes, simple quadratic potential case, let's say. Then you find this is proportional to n squared, the number of equals, from the end of inflation up to some point. So actually, this is a non-negligible, very large factor which can make the amplitude large. And actually, it comes from, so this formula may be written in terms of so-called epsilon parameter. So you have this 1 over epsilon factor, and epsilon, actually, 1 over epsilon is essentially proportional to n squared. So that's the fairly general relation. I mean, of course, there are many other models which has different n dependence, but this n dependence of epsilon proportional to 1 over n squared, I think it's valid for Stravinsky's model as well. Anyway, if you assume this to be 10 minus 10, of course, then you need to obtain all these values. So this was this was quite old. This slice is quite old. This is before this all this Planck constraint on tensor amplitude. The scale amplitude was roughly consistent with this n squared pi squared model. And we were excited at that time, of course, because this predict that actually the energy scale of inflation is 10 to 16 GeV, and this so-called scalar to tensor ratio is about 0.1. And then it will soon be observed. Mm-hmm. Even the Planck could see it, we hope. But it was unconscious that now it's sort of disappeared. But anyway, so something about tensor correlations. Let me just go through quickly. So in the case of tensor correlations, actually turns out it's much simpler than a scalar type correlation because they are gauge invariant from the beginning, so you don't have to worry about any gauge transformation or anything. You just write down the action. This is very close to the case of this Coulomb gauge action in electromagnetics or in case of gravity, people will transfer stress gauge. But anyway, the whole point is that if you introduce kind of a canonical field by absorbing the Planck mass into the fluctuation of the metric, then actually you see that it is completely identical, apart from these two indices, identical to the massless minimally coupled scalar field action. So then it's almost trivial to compute the fluctuation amplitude, approach amplitude for each. You have 2 degrees of freedom, so 1 degree of freedom h over 2 pi squared times 2. And then because of this factor, if you want to compute the fluctuations in the power of h, you just convert this. So you have 2 times h over 2 pi squared times inverse of this 4 over n squared, and it gives you this answer. So then you can compute the tensor to scalar ratio, which is just the ratio between this and the scalar part, scaled by this. And if a phi dot is very small, r is small, but for m squared phi squared, the r is slightly greater than 0.1. And so this was detectable, could have been detected. But unfortunately, Okay. Seems to have excluded it already. Okay. This is about spectral index. Spectral index is essentially defined by taking sort of a derivative to rest of k, or logarithmic derivative to rest of k. And then factor k cubed, this is to make everything sort of non-dimensional, right? And take into account the phase volume. But anyway, the important thing is that the assuming kh, Hubble parameter, is slowly rolling, then derivative of k, or log of the k, is just dA dA and dA over A. This variation in h can be completely ignored within one expansion time. So this means this is just a derivative set to a number of equals. So actually, when you take the derivative of this result, you just take the take the derivative of this function with respect to this number of equals, and evaluate that at the rising cross. And so this is an easy exercise. We know that this is given by 8 to the fourth by the time of the square. And you just take the time derivative of this, and you use the slow roll diffusion motion, you get this formula. And for any sort of polynomial potential with n positive, this ns is less than 1. So this is a very important point, and which Slava Mukhanov always has emphasized. And actually, in his case, this is his computation is another thing. I mean, you know, he did his computation with scalar perturbations before everybody was talking about inflation. He used this Stravinsky's model and compute. And he computed the spectrum in terms of the sort of this gravitational potential perturbation. Sorry. This gravitational potential perturbation in the radiation the relation between the conservative and this depends on this equation state. And actually, if you evaluate that during a inflation, then the value is very, very different. It is actually, there is this epsilon factor in front. So his evaluation of amplitude itself is completely wrong. But he didn't care. That's again his smartness. He didn't talk about amplitude. He only talked about spectral index. And spectral index, of course, doesn't depend on the amplitude. Yeah. So he got the correct result before everybody, and he said that you have this sort of slightly red spectrum. Yes, yeah, less than one. So interesting story, actually. Anyway, so and actually this seems to be the case. The only unfortunate thing is that they at least, maybe fortunate even for them, is that now the standard simplest model doesn't work, but you have this a little bit complicated but interesting model, R square inflation. A Stravinsky model works much better. Yes. Anyway. And of course, here is this famous so called consistency relation between the spectral index of the tensor perturbation and this tensor to scale ratio. So if R was like 0.1, this could have been detected, could be detected within a few years perhaps. But since R seems to be much less than 0.1, nobody knows whether you can actually obtain this. If this was greater than people say, and ultimately, if this observed value will be greater than 0.01, then you can probably compute anything. And at least, see if this relation is consistent. if the consistent relation is consistent or not can be seen. But if it is less than R, is less than this, then there's no hope to see detect the spherical index. That's a bit unfortunate thing.
Can you apply this formula to both of low and high scale inflation?
Yeah. Yes. So in fact, this means that the low scale inflation, this is zero, almost exactly zero. So, I mean, if you can detect very low scale tensor spectrum by some amplification like I discussed sometime ago, then you may be able to see this spectral index. But otherwise, there's no hope, because the amplitude itself is too small.
But this relation is model dependent.
Oh, yeah. No. This is only smaller, singularly smaller.
Other inflationary model in which
That's right. So actually, there is always a possibility. Oh, wait. Not quite. The whole point is that single field solar inflation gives the biggest R. Mm-hmm. If you add, as it's this is purely determined by H square. So you see the H square. And the, if you increase the number of degrees of freedom scale here, you increase the denominator and make R smaller.
Is the DPI inflation, I think, and have a big arm. That was popular. When the last R was popular, I think people talk about this kind of model.
Yeah. But this assumes that the Hubble parameter is large. Mm. So in the small field models, Hubble is always small. Absolute value of Hubble is small. So you cannot really increase this amplitude. Mm-hmm. Because this amplitude is fixed. I mean, by the energy scale of inflation. If you make the energy scale of inflation small, there's no way to make it large.
Mm-hmm.
The only way to enhance this is maybe you introduce this massive tensor modes during inflation, or maybe at the end of inflation, so that these oscillations can enhance the amplitude parametrically. And in this case, since it is broad resonance, I mean, it doesn't depend on frequency, so everything just goes up. But otherwise, I think there's no other way to make this R large on large scale. Large scale means that the large scale where we do know the amplitude of the scale of our vision. Okay. Right. So this is the result, and I think I don't have to talk too much about the dependence and so on and so forth. So this is the summary from a few years ago, but anyway. So this I will talk about this the dynamorphism soon. This was the time of the bicep, which is 3 years, 4 years ago already. Unfortunately, it's gone. So forget about the summary part. Okay. So. Any questions, please? Maybe you
there's a paper by Mukhanov, so I don't know if I didn't read it, but in the paper is not this one. There's an enhancement.
So this was I think this essentially means that you just choose the very large Hubble parameter without, okay, in that sense even they, you have the small field models, the energy scale can be high. Maybe that's the point. That's a possibility. So, but it's what I'm saying that when we think of small field models, which is almost equivalent to small energy scale model, low energy models. And in the case of low energy models, half is small, so you cannot increase. Mm-hmm. That's the point. And mm-hmm. I think they are saying that you may consider some kind of small field models.
Okay. Where
the
H can be.
But if that's the case, I mean, maybe you have, I don't know. So in this fast rolling case, since phi dot is large, actually the distance you travel can easily exceed the Hubble, I mean, Planck mass, huh?
Mm-hmm.
So maybe in that sense, maybe you are not avoiding so-called Weiss bound. And if you don't worry about the Weiss bound, of course, everything, there's no constraint in. You can mm-hmm. do anything you want. To make Hubble large. Oh. Yeah. Sorry.
I think they satisfy the life bound also.
It does satisfy?
I think
if you have a very large gamma, means that the phi dot is almost one, huh? Or something. I mean, maybe depending on this, you are talking about some pre-factor? But I think. Oh yes, maybe you tune, you turn. Okay, now I started to understand. You turn the something like this, right? This is 1 over f squared plus, and then phi dot squared. If you do this by choosing f probably large, then you can, the other way, huh? Did you say? Yeah, small, the phi dot can be very small. Yes. Probably this is the model. Yes. Yeah. If you do that, yes. If you make f5 is small in Planck units, mm-hmm. then phi dot becomes very small. Yet the gamma can be very large.
Yeah.
Probably that's the model. Okay. Sorry.
Anyway, it doesn't work.
Yeah. Anyhow, by the way, yes. It's now it's because of this, especially here. And non-Gaussian constraint, which is very, very severe.
Yeah.
Yes, the CS square constraint. Yeah. Now, this sound velocity should be greater than, I think, 0.1 or so. And this is a very, very small. Because, in those models, this is always much smaller than one. Okay. Yeah, so then 10 minutes break,
yeah.
And then go back to the home. Yes.
The whole scale.
Oh, but this one. We went to Singapore this, with the Singapore.
Yeah.
Okay. What's the name of it? Sun.
Do they have a Western note?
You
can
call
them?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah,
I'll
tell you. Then I asked.
Seems
like you already have the
lower
bound.
What about
the lower bound?
Oh, yeah. We have four here. I asked a couple more people. So I asked Saki.
You asked already.
No, I haven't asked.
Oh.
Maybe some
coastal
also.
I gave you the number.
Which
do you know?
It's in my
Spectator
Pro.
Soon.
But she might be not pro, huh?
Yeah. Just in case she is a pro, so that she knows.
Yeah.
About the revision.
What? Okay.
I'm still thinking. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I have to go back to the very basic. Transformation does not change it.
Unless there's some large obstruction. Locally, you still have the symmetry. Because you can killing the equation is spatial, right? We can determine the symmetry of the space by solving the number killing the equation and becoming the killing vector. So those doing gate transformation wouldn't change those equations. Mm-hmm. The existence of fusion may depend on some global choice of point.
That's the point.
Yeah.
That's the fact.
So I suggest that you could solve the clean equation using the new metric and then try to see the existence. That's what I have to say.
So then if we localize the string like Toulang as the rotational symmetry, so
we are here.
But if we use super transcendent symmetry, I'm talking about spherical symmetry.
Yeah, how do you define rotational symmetry?
After that,
you want to do some theta, go to theta plus pi, that kind of thing, or you want to do x equal to tau, and make it some x. What do you mean by spherical symmetry? So my understanding is you don't have to spread. If you map the symmetry of the space, you have to do that.
Yes.
The whole symmetry then you have to do
that. Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know.
The new one.
Oh, okay.
The new one.
Yeah.